Welcome everyone. We're going to put a little structure to this video. I mean, some people like to have a little bit of structure. We'll start out with the creed. I put together a creed here, a statement. It is, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me to be. Let's see if I can remember. I have no needs. There is no world. I see only the vision of oneness, the miraculous play of the living light here, now. I am free. I am free. I am free of objectivity. Yes, yes, yes. This is the creed. Let's try it again. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me to be. I have no needs. There is no world. I see only the vision of oneness, the miraculous play of living light here, now. I am free. I am free. I am free of objectivity. Yes, yes, yes. All right. And then we make the confession, which is very simple. I confess that I have a very severe continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. It's the only problem there is. It's the only problem I will ever have. I will never have another problem, but I do have a very severe continuity problem. That's the confession. Then we go on to continuity practice and say, I do not have a body problem. I have a continuity problem. The body problem doesn't exist and therefore has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I do not have a need problem. I have a continuity problem. The need problem does not exist. Therefore, it has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I do not have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. The world problem doesn't exist. Therefore, it has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I do not have a delay problem. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. The delay problem does not exist. Only, therefore, has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I do not have an oblivion problem. I have a continuity problem. The oblivion problem does not exist. Therefore, it has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. All right, so keeping it very simple, then we can move on to the next part of this new liturgy, new way liturgy, the new liturgy here. Silent sitting and affirmations, declarations. The extremely important one is relax my mind, release my thoughts, and let them go. I relax my mind, I release my thoughts, I let them go. I relax my mind, I release my thoughts, I let them go. I relax my mind, I release my thoughts, I let them go. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me to be. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me to be. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me to be. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me to be. Very, very important. Now, as we do declarations, consternation arises. Shifting shifts and shift. And the consternation over shifts will happen. That's where the silent sitting. We stay quiet, we stay silent, we stay quiet, and we listen. We just be present right now in the present moment. Not the past, not the future, not parallel to the present. Just right here now. I abide in the here-free-hereness of the now-free-nowness. 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 Reality has no needs. Reality has no needs. Reality has no needs. One moment. Okay, it's not about me, it's not about you. It's about us and co-creation with God. It's not about me, it's not about you. It's about us and co-creation with God. It's not about me, it's not about you. It's about us and co-creation with God. Now, I put together this little sequence of a liturgical sequence to give a little structure to help people out. Just so they feel like, you know, they can get into it. They can get into it. Absolutely get into it. Get aligned with it, because the content that we bring in the when we do a talk and when we do these declaration affirmations is very intense, very intense. Now we acknowledge the help of our root guru, our root guru, Jesus Christ, who is pure clarity, completely free of all taint of continuity, problem, fear. Completely free of all taint of any continuity, problem, fear. Absolutely present here today. Completely capable of transmitting pure clarity to all of us. We acknowledge the presence of the Holy Spirit, which is always present with us, guiding our lives in every way, guiding us toward realization that we are not a body, we are free, we are still spirit exactly as God created us to be. So, with the help that we have, how can we fail? How can we fail? How can we fail to realize, this is what happened. This is what happened. So, the four pillars of preparation, and remember, I'm calling this an ordeal. This is an ordeal of preparation. Every time you go into spiritual effort to recognize and to realize, effort that eventuates in non-dual absolute abidance, or abidance in the absolute non-dual. Okay, abidance in the absolute non-dual, non-dual absolute abidance. This is the goal. It is absolutely reachable. In fact, everyone has to reach this goal. And from that perspective, we will see that it's all there is. It's all there is. We've always been there. Okay. In order to reach this, we need to go through an ordeal of preparation. Ordeal of preparation. Every time we make an effort, and it should be daily effort, maybe three efforts per day if possible. This is my second effort of the day, actually third. Start off with over a 2-hour video, just super intense. Then redid the whole website, most a lot of the website and intense effort on the website. Now I'm doing a second video here, introducing some structure here. This is intense. See, it's an ordeal. The preparation. It's an ordeal of preparation. So every time you make an effort, let it be an ordeal, which means shifting your comfort zone into new territory. Shift your comfort zone into new territory. Difficult. It's an ordeal. There's resistance, and you have to look at it. It says, this is going to be an ordeal, but I am going to do it. This is going to happen here. This is how you prepare. This is how we prepare. It's an ordeal. It's not just some picnic. It's an ordeal. Every time, it's an ordeal. It's like digging a hole. It's never going to be easy. You're right. It is never going to be easy. If it's easy, you're spinning your wheels. Don't settle for easy. Don't settle for easy. Insist, this is going to be an ordeal. I am going to move my comfort zone. I have to. Because the alternative is to continue to pursue oblivion. To continue to pursue oblivion, which we do through identifying with bodies, worlds, and death. Okay. And that is no picnic either, believe me. And you know very well that it is no picnic. So, just eagerly say, yeah, give me the ordeal. I want the ordeal. Let's do this ordeal of preparation. Ordeal of preparation. We need to gather our nerves. Sometimes we need to take some quiet time just to gather our nerves. It's a workout. It is a workout. You want to leave this feeling like, wow, I just got a real spiritual workout here. And I can feel it, but you know, that's great. Now, I keep trying to revamp the website to keep pace of what's going on. Is very difficult because so much has been changing so rapidly. But what I've pointed out now is an acknowledgement, of course, that I cannot be a root guru or teacher guru while I'm still in this world. That's not possible. It's not possible for anyone. It's not possible for me. It's not possible for you. So don't worry about it. We don't need to worry about that at all. The best that anyone can do here is help us go through this ordeal of preparation and bring about a feeling like that maybe I can succeed at this. You know, maybe I can succeed. Maybe it's powerful. Say, hey, maybe I can succeed at this. Then you don't say, well, I'm for sure I know I can. We can say that, but at the feeling level, there's like, well, maybe I can. Maybe I can get some help. Maybe this is helpful. Okay, but the actual transmission of pure clarity that occurs between us and the root teacher guru, if you want to call it the Holy Spirit, you can also call it the Holy Spirit. I call Jesus the Hammer, my nickname, because we have these few little, the stuff that needs to be ironed out, so to speak, and say, hey, I really need no punches pulled here. Let's see what's really going on. And he brings the hammer to that. He goes, okay, let's hit this hard for sure. He's not shy about hitting it hard. Let's get to this. There is no body. There are no needs. There is no world. Okay, there is no world. Absolutely not. Now, this is what I'm talking about, bringing the hammer. He wants you to finish. So he pushes you along a fast track. That's what we want, right? Because if we're not on a fast track to realization, then we're on a fast track to pursuing oblivion. It's one of the two. Just keep that in mind. It's one of the two. Always keep that in mind. So Jesus said, hey, go faster, more urgent. Put yourself through the ordeal. Come on. Let's I want to bring the hammer down on this. Let's keep at it. Now, so we cannot be these great gurus here in this world. That's not possible, actually, because we maintain a vestige of familiarity with relationships and belief in a world and bodies and relationships and stuff like that. Even though we're free of that, there'll still be some faint, when we get free, there'll still be some faint, you know, familiarity with that, right? So what do we do with that? Give it to Jesus. Say, okay, I have a friendship with Jesus. Jesus says he can take that and harmonize it, and it's not a problem at all. That frees us up here to be the impersonal here-ness that all is. Okay, the impersonal here-ness that all is. Very important. Because we're here, it's presumed we have duration. Because we're here, it's presumed there's a world. So we can't be entirely trusting of one another here. Okay, but we can trust in one, the root teacher guru, who's not here. We can put real tremendous faith and trust in that one. Really can. We can get to that point. But the ones that are here, we're interacting with them, we say, you know, they can't be that great. It's not possible. You know, it's just, I can't quite trust them. That's fine. Let's not put that burden upon us. It shouldn't be upon us at all. That's the reason why there are these root teachers, gurus, various lineages, okay, various outreaches of great God's grace. That's why they're there, to be used, to be helpful, to be effective, to be pragmatic. So we, above all else, are pragmatic, as is the Holy Spirit, pragmatic. So the most I can do is, you know, help out, encourage, reassure and encourage, and help people go through this ordeal of preparation. You know, do it. You know, let's see if we need some structure, we'll structure it and get people going on that. It's an ordeal. It's hard to get people going on an ordeal, but once you start realizing, hey, you know, this is actually working. And the alternative is to the endless ordeal of pursuing oblivion. Okay, keep in mind there is no oblivion. So when you see oblivion as your only hope, you're going to be pursuing it endlessly. You'll never find it. You won't find it in death. You will not find oblivion in death. There is no oblivion in death. None. You will not find it. You will not find it in rebirth either. You will not find it in rebirth in this world. You will not find it in death. You will not find it in the afterlife. You will not ever find oblivion. So, what's the problem? We have a severe continuity problem. Because we have been presuming that we can't find it. And therefore valuing all these identifications and definitions that we've been making about bodies and things and places, about time, space. We've been valuing time, space, which doesn't exist. But how do we get from valuing this as if it was saving us from total insanity and falling into an abyss of total definitional chaos? How do we set it down, see? And for what? For perfect, absolute stillness, absolute silence, absolute peace, pure happiness. That's a huge, 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 huge variance, right? So we have a continuity problem between these two. The variance here equals a severe continuity problem. We don't just shift from one to the other permanently like that. We can get a glimpse of pure happiness, vision of oneness, but then we go, whoa, that is so different than what I'm used to. Wow, you know, how in the world can I integrate that? You don't integrate it, actually. You just be it. You just be it. Doesn't need to be integrated. It's already the case. But the feeling, how do I integrate that, reflects our continuity fear. It says, wow, I'm really scared. This the variance is just too extreme. Totally extreme. There is no abyss. There is no mental chaos. There is no definitional chaos. Well, when we stop trying to be greater than God, there is no definition then. No need to put any definition of greater and lesser. So there is no definition at all. If there's no definitions being made, How can there be definitional chaos? There cannot be. There cannot be. All definition is definitional chaos, actually. Any definition we try to put on reality, simply like that, chain reactions. So we have to repent and say, I don't want to be greater than God. I want to drop this silly whim and work on our continuity problem. When we see that nothing we've ever done, no identification, no definition, no path we've ever pursued towards oblivion has actually ever gone anywhere. Nothing's ever happened. There haven't been any paths. When we see that, we say, wow. And that starts creeping in our mind. Wait a minute. Well, how do I find oblivion then? This is scary. How do I find it? How do I find safety? We equate pursuing oblivion with safety because it's an assumption that we're in the process of finding it. When we recognize there's never been any process take place at all. Every moment is completely fresh, free, and clear of every other moment. The complete freedom of this present moment is not bound by the next moment at all. And then we realize, wait a minute, there's no process at all. There's no path, there's no process. How can I pursue oblivion? And that shakes you up. The fear arises then. The fear is really in not finding oblivion, because we're running from this terrible experiencing of total, an abyss of total definitional chaos. And we're so afraid of that we're terrified of not finding oblivion. Where is oblivion? So how do we get there? Everyone says, yeah, there's a way. We all believe there's a way. That's why we're all here in this world, identifying with bodies, believing there's a world, believing there's process, believing there's things, believing there's time, space, all of which there is not. But it represents hope to us. We hope. It says, yeah, we're going to find it. Together, we'll find it together. If we just join together, we're going to find it. Gosh, let's be nice to one another. Yeah, okay, we're going to find this together. We'll find it. That represents hope. And in it is a defense against this dread, this terrible dread of the abyss of definitional chaos. So when we repent and say, okay, I don't want to be greater than God, there's no need to define reality, therefore, in terms of greater or lesser. There's no need to put any definitions on reality whatsoever. So there's no definitions at all. So there can't be definitional chaos at all. Therefore, I don't need to find oblivion at all. Therefore, won't scare me, frighten me to see that there's never been actually any single step ever taken in the pursuit of oblivion. You know, we believe that, again, the process of searching for oblivion is very important. Hope, see, because we figure if we don't have that, we have no hope. So this is our greatest hope. At least we can pursue it. But then we realize in abidance in the non-dual absolute, we realize, oh, wow, nothing's ever happened at all. There are no paths. There's nothing to get. There's nothing to attain. There's nothing to realize. There's nothing to find. All of that actually relates to our pursuit of oblivion. There is no oblivion. There's only this all omnipresent here-ness, the omnipresent now-ness, the omnipresent is-ness, the omnipresent pure spaciousness, the omnipresent oneness. And it's a shock. I said, wait a minute. I don't see any process. So eventually this you know, the continuity problem here of it's so different, like, wow, eventually it seeps back into you, like, well, maybe there's at least a little bit of progress somewhere, and you look for that. And then you're no longer abiding in the non-dual absolute. And then you keep working the ordeal of preparation of evaporating our continuity fear, We just keep on with it, realizing, hey, we're getting very close to realizing nothing ever happened. No pursuit ever took place. There's never been any pursuit take place whatsoever. This is what we're talking about, bringing the hammer down. There's never been any pursuit whatsoever. There's never been any pursuit whatsoever of anything. Pursuit is impossible. Pursuit is absolutely impossible. Wherever we go, we're always exactly where we've always been. Wherever we go, we're always exactly where we've always been. Wherever we go, we're always exactly where we've always been. Powerful declaration. Wherever we go, we're always exactly where we've always been. Wherever I go, I'm always exactly where I've always been. Wherever we go, we're always exactly where we've always been. Wherever anything ever goes, it's always exactly where it's always been. So how can we say that there's a pursuit? How can we say that there's a path? There is no path, there is no pursuit. Wherever we go, we're always exactly where we've always been. There is no path, there is no pursuit. Wherever we go, we're always exactly where we have always been. Pure spaciousness, without the need of the slightest adjustment to be perfectly aligned with pure spaciousness. We're always perfectly aligned. I am always perfectly aligned. I am always perfectly aligned. I am always perfectly aligned. We are always perfectly aligned. We are always perfectly aligned. We are always perfectly aligned. Now, if there should become a time when well, on these videos, we can start out when I'm saying like these declarations, I'll say them three times, and then see if you can see them, say them three times. That's the basic way that it will go if I'm ever going to actually hang out with others in this world. I don't know. I don't have any plans one way or the other. It could happen. It might not happen. But so I. What was the declaration? I forgot. I'm always exactly where I've always been. We can try that. I'm always exactly where I've always been. I'm always exactly where I've always been. I'm always exactly where I've always been. So, it's okay. It's okay if you forget. If I forget, it doesn't matter because another one's just as good. Another one's just as good. So you can practice saying that. And then be quiet. It helps when we're bringing the hammer down like this to have someone, you know, take the initiative, break the ice on these declarations, and then you can do them too. And you say, wow, okay. Because it is the icebreaker function to make these, to bring the hammer down this way and make these declarations. It absolutely is. And sometimes it's so intense that we forget what we just said. After I did the video, the one previous to this one, which is, I can't even remember what the name of it is, but where I introduced Oblivion. I couldn't remember the term Oblivion. It's the first time I've ever used it, and it was just absolute key. I couldn't remember it afterwards. I spent an hour while just thinking. I could not remember it, so I had to go to the video and watch it to remember what the term was. That is continuity fear. Okay, unbelievable, right? Couldn't even remember the great breakthrough that I had. That's continuity fear. It's continuity fear. So we may make a declaration that's just tremendous, and then the next moment we can't remember what we said, which it just happened. I can't remember. That's okay. That's okay. That means you're really bringing the hammer down. Bringing the hammer down. Also means that probably we need to have a quiet spell, let this settle in, because we may just be like, wow, this is very intense. And sometimes the mind will go blank, we can't remember, because it's so intense, we're just more concerned like, oh my gosh, I hope everything's okay. You know, deep inside, that's what we're feeling. We may not admit it to ourselves, but deep inside we're saying, uh-oh, You know, this is kind of scary. And then we won't be able to remember getting a number what the declaration was. So this is a little structure. I'm trying to come up with a little structure in the eventuality, which seems to be like a certainty. As I said in the other video, I can't remember what I titled it, part one and part two on August 16th. Something about oblivion. Getting free from the pursuit of oblivion or something like that. Getting free of oblivion. And then when this continuity fear, when we're like in shock and stunned like this, it's hard to remember train of thought too. It can be difficult to remember that, which is perfectly fine. It doesn't matter. The intensity of this, I said, well, I cannot not be realized now. I cannot not be realized at this point. I cannot not be realized at this point. I can't go back and not be not realized. It's too late for that. So we'll see how it goes. But I'm preparing in case we might say the certitude at some point where realization will abidance in non-dual absolute will be here. And what to do then, I don't know. Maybe still make videos, maybe do nothing, maybe meet up with those who want, you know, the ordeal preparation, who match up with what's being offered here, and say, yeah, this is what I want. And so there needs to be a little bit of a structure, a little bit of liturgy to the situation. It's helpful just to get people settling in and say, okay, I know how to start. And we know how to end. We know how the middle go. We know there's a little structure, so I can at least feel like I'm going through the steps here, you know, instead of it's just like completely free form. That's probably, you know, too difficult to just completely free form it with, you know, a group of people. Yeah. With yourself, you can do it, right? But everybody's in a different place, and so when there's a group of people, there needs to be some structure there that people can at least say, well, at least I'm keeping up with the structure. I may not quite understand, you know, this is all like new and you know, wow, but I'm able to keep up with the structure, so it's helpful. Because we are bringing the hammer down here, there's no question, we have to, because the pursuit of oblivion is becoming rabid. Okay, when you see a mean looking dog going down the street, you say, well, that dog better not come in here. I'm not afraid of that dog. But really, you're kind of worried, hey, I hope that dog doesn't come in here. Yeah. Okay, but when you see like a rabid dog going down the street, you know, foam dripping off his mouth, looking crazy, rabid dog, you know, you go into the house and close your doors, you know, and he's like, oh, I need to get to safety right now. I'm not going to put up some bluff like, hey, Don't come in here, dog. Go out to the driveway and look at the dog. Don't you dare come in here. You're not going to do that to a rabid dog. You're going to get in the house. So the world is rapidly pursuing oblivion. Okay? It's not just your ordinary pursuit of oblivion, which we've been doing for so long, which we hate so much, actually. This is a rabid pursuit of oblivion. And if this doesn't have your attention at this time, then you may already been bit by the rabid dog. You know, you may be already, you know, and just out of it or something. I mean, it's undeniable that there's just this intense pursuit of oblivion, actually. Through intense identification with the body, intense identification with the world, intense identification with needs, right? Intense, rabid. Now this is the dog you want to get away from. You want to get away from that dog entirely. So that's why I'm saying we have to bring the hammer down. I asked Jesus, hey, bring the hammer down. now. And he's doing it. He's doing it. He's doing it. He's not saying, well, you know, I don't know. Should I do this? Can I do this? You know, no. Jesus knows how to bring the hammer down. And so you ask him, he will. That's what we're asking, because that's what's needed right now. So a little bit of structure can help out there. A little bit of structure can help out there. We can all accept a little bit of structure. That's not going to ruin anyone's day, actually, because the alternative is what? That rabid dog of oblivion is foaming at the mouth and coming at you. And it's, you know, you say no, it doesn't hear your no. It doesn't hear your no. You try to scare it, it doesn't scare. It's crazy. So, it's rabid, so get in the house, close your door. Bring the hammer down and say, hey, I have no body, I have no needs, there is no world. I am not a body. There are no needs, there is no world. I am not a body. There are no needs, there is no world. I am not a body, I have no needs. There is no world. There is no universe. There is no time. There is no space. And mean it when you say it. You're saying, hey, this is true. This is a fact. Now I'm talking facts. There is no body. There is no need. There are no needs. There is no world. There is no universe. There is no time. There is no space. There's only the here-ness. There's only the here-ness. Now, a lot of people are playing casual. Like, well, yeah, I see the dog down the street, but maybe it won't come down this my street. I see that rabid dog. Oh boy. Well, it won't come down here. I don't think so. Let me ignore it. No, it's coming to a neighborhood near you, believe me. This is a global situation. This is a global situation we are in. This is a massive, not only global, but solar system, galaxy, cosmic. This is a massive, massive push of pursuit of oblivion, a huge pursuit to pursue oblivion, which is seen as safety, the only safety there could be. We don't even know oblivion is. We just feel like we've got to reach. We don't know exactly. Obviously, it's crazy. How could it be safety? How could oblivion be safety? That's how crazy scared we are. And we don't even think about it. We said, I can't think about it. I just got to find it, which is why death. Everyone believes death is oblivion. So they're eager for death. You know, I was at a store recently, and this young lady was a clerk there, cashier. And she was bored, not much going on. And so I come, okay, she starts ringing up the purchase. And I look, and she has this sheet there, and she's been doodling. Okay, I sort of noticed the sheet and went, what? Do a second take. All skulls, death skulls, death skulls, death skulls. If you pay attention in the world, you'll be amazed at how many people. And I saw this guy right there, and then and the other, another cashier, with this short shirt, with this hideous death skull on the shirt. Well, this is like a, you know, an older man, actually. You'd be amazed at how many death skulls you see all over the place if you just pay attention. You will see them in tattoos. I mean, some of the tattoos on people, I can't even believe. You know, it's just the most vicious death stuff possible. You can even imagine. I can't even imagine this stuff they're tattooing on themselves. This is an insane desire and pursuit of oblivion. Okay, and death represents oblivion to us. Death represents oblivion. It represents safety from definitional chaos. It's the idea of no experiencing. Somehow in oblivion, there's just no experiencing. and we'll be free of that terrible, you know, chaos, definitional chaos, which is truly is absolutely intolerable. Of course, there is no oblivion. There is no oblivion. Form, time, space is the pursuit of the Holy Grail, or the unholy grail of oblivion. So next time you think, wow, this is not coming to my neighborhood, just check out all the decibels as you go out and around, and the decals, and this is an expression. People put decals on their cars, they wear shirts. There's lots of ways that people express themselves about what's really going on inside of them. Okay, they're saying, they're kind of giving out clues, hoping they can attract like-minded people, okay? And if you see all these clues and it's all about death, 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 what do you think their purpose here is? It's death. You may think people come here to live. No, they don't. They come here to die. Everyone comes here to die. Identifying with the body is for the purpose of dying, thinking that you're going to find oblivion then. There's no other reason to do so unless you're a savior coming in just to communicate the truth to people. Other than that, you're coming here to die to this world. This world is all about death. In fact, the belief in a world is all about the belief in death. We believe there's a special place, that we found this place, a place, special location in time and space, where we're going to find oblivion and be free, free of our fears. This is not so. This is not so. So we continue on in these cycles and cycles and cycles. And we might be saying, well, I can't believe this. I'm hearing this. I can't believe it. I'm hearing this. I can't believe it. I'm hearing this. Wow, 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 wow. Is this a dream? Is this a dream? I mean, I came here to die, and now I'm hearing clarification that, you know what, maybe I don't have to die. Maybe I can give up death, actually. Because death is actually just the pursuit of oblivion. If there's no oblivion, why should I keep pursuing it? Why should I keep pursuing what doesn't exist, can never be found? It's ridiculous. And death is just the pursuit of oblivion. Identifying with the body is just the pursuit of oblivion. The death of the body is just the pursuit of oblivion. And it's all a dream. It's all a dream pursuit. It's a dream pursuit. There's no other way to pursue anything, because there is no pursuit in reality. You can't pursue anything. Everything is already here. It's impossible to pursue anything. So obviously oblivion's not there. So we gotta dream, imagine that we're pursuing it. And this bodies, worlds, time, space is the dream pursuit of oblivion. Once you recognize that, see, I don't have to pursue oblivion. It's not there, and it's not findable, it's not there, it doesn't exist. So, wow, I can just be here now. And actually, the body doesn't even need to die. You can let it die, if that's fine too. It means nothing anymore, doesn't mean anything. Or you can, some choose to not have it die for a while. That's possible too. Some turn it into a light body, and there's various things you can do, actually. But we don't need to obsess about that or focus too much on it. But the main thing is that, you see, I can't believe I'm actually hearing this, actually paying attention to this. It's like, wow, I thought I came here to die, but not really. I said, maybe I'm going to come here to die, but maybe not. Maybe not. So you maybe get to this, like, hey, maybe not. Maybe not. Maybe not. You know, these people of the world, all these death skulls, they think getting bit by the rabid dog is a benediction. It's a blessing. It's their savior. The rabid dog is their savior. That's what they believe. But you know better, don't you? You know better that getting bit by that rabid dog of the pursuit of oblivion is a hellish, hellish, hellish situation. You're going to become very animalistic. You're going to turn into that rabid dog, actually. It's kind of like a zombie apocalypse. You keep turning into zombies, you know. Everyone's turning into a zombie here in this world, actually. A death zombie. Zombies are simply in the pursuit of oblivion, is what zombies are. And most of the people on this planet are in full zombie mode, actually. Full zombie mode. It's kind of scary when you see all these zombies coming after you. It's like, whoa, I think I want to get away from that. So we say, hey, Jesus, bring the hammer down. Hammer time. It's hammer time. It really is hammer time now. And the hammer is the declarations. The hammer is the declarations we're making. Man, they keep coming up. Very powerful, very potent ones. Very potent. And the zombies, you know, they go back from there. It's like, oh, God. Too much light, you know. Scared. They grumble and they growl and they shuffle off somewhere else. If you can't think of an affirmation, it means that you've already brought up a tremendous amount of consternation and intensity, which is fine. That's good. That means progress is, you know, in full swing, full swing. There's this extreme in this world zest for death now, an extreme desire for it. It's just dripping off of it. People can hardly keep it under control. You know, they have to play these video games, killing everybody constantly, just to keep the idea of death in their minds, death in their minds. They have to watch news constantly, keep TV constantly, keep the idea of death in mind. Go view, you know, internet news sites, magazines, radio, which is constantly pouring, non-stop torrent of death-related stories, constantly. So people are just fanatically immersing themselves in a culture of death because this is their hope of safety. They hope it will lead them to oblivion. Now, in remembering my previous lives, I realize it doesn't lead you to oblivion. That's a lie. That's a lie. You find yourself back here. Same old problems, same old fear, same old dread. Gets you nowhere, gets you nowhere. So I remember the first step I took on towards this ordeal of preparation for non-dual absolute abidance was to say, I can never use death as an answer anymore. I can never use death as an answer. It's not an answer. That's the first, like, foundational step. I said, I'm not going to use it as an answer, because it's not. I know that it's not. And then that really propelled me every step of the way. There's always a choice. Should I continue to pursue oblivion, hoping that works? Or do I say, no, it doesn't work. Death doesn't work. Death does not work. Doesn't matter how you die, it doesn't work. Now, people here are geared up to die in every possible way they can. You know, there's constant creative ways of dying, right? And the media keeps trumpeting every last death, weird death, the media has to put front and center, right? Splashed all over the place. Hey, they died in this way. And everybody goes, huh, that's interesting. You know, people reading books, murder mysteries, right? They're always trying to look at all the different ways you can die. And they're secretly hoping, maybe I can do it that way. Maybe I can find oblivion that way. It's a culture of death. It's an absolute culture of death in this world to the nth degree. And it's getting worse and worse and worse every moment. So I said to Jesus, hey, bring the hammer down. Hey, bring it. Bring it. Bring it. Bring it. Bring it. We need it. So we're kind of leapfrogging the whole situation. The intensity here is leapfrogging the situation. And you know, either you just say, oh yeah, okay, I'm going to do it, or not. And if not, the zombies are coming for you. They're coming for you for sure. This is not an exaggeration at all. This is what's happening. So, you know, the ordeal of preparation is really cool. It's actually quite fun. It's like, wow, this is much better than anything else I could do. Way better. Way better. It's not bad at all. It's not bad at all. Now, the zombies may not like it. They don't like anything except pursuing oblivion. That's all that they like, actually. That's all that they like. Anything else, they want to run away from as fast as possible. They're not really your friends, are they? The zombies. Zombies in pursuit of oblivion. They're not really your friends. Because there is no oblivion. They're just wasting your time. They're just drag you down into hell. And for no reason. How are they your friends? They don't know how to be friends, actually. They're suffering from extremely severe continuity fear. And so, you know, eventually they'll need someone to show them the way and to help out. So if you want to be their friend, don't let them drag you down into the friendless condition of pursuit of oblivion. Not at all. Don't do that. Now, if you really want friendship, be a friend of Jesus. Be a friend of Jesus. Don't try to project friendship in this world among bodies that are here and stuff. It's putting too much demand. It doesn't work. What you do is support the ordeal of preparation. Just support the ordeal of preparation. That is what is helpful. But as far as like a relationship of friendship, no. Don't do that. That will mess everything up. Because you're here for the ordeal of preparation. You're here for that. This is what you got to do. You can't really, and the thing is it's so freaky here, okay, with all these zombies, the whole world full of zombies in pursuit of oblivion. And the very fact that anybody is here, you can't help but feel like maybe they're, you know, might be a zombie too. I'm not sure. They may turn into one at some time. You can't really establish a true friendship under these conditions. But with Jesus, you can. You can. You can realize, hey, no, he's got it. No continuity fear there for sure. It's not going to go bad on you, for sure. So put your friendship there and then be friends with Jesus. And then you can visit with him and ask him, hey, Jesus, bring the hammer down, please. And he will. He'll help you out. You can trust him. The rest of us here, you can't really trust entirely. It doesn't matter who they are, who they say they are, even if they're perfect saint, whatever. You're still going to say, wow. Just a collective freak out of this planet, of this presumed planet, is scary. You know, it does have an effect upon us. It does have an effect upon us. So, if we just take care of business, and look at it is that this, we're just here to go through this ordeal preparation, then we're not concerned about that. You know, take care of business. Get it done. As long as you're getting it done, that's fine. That's good enough. Don't try to form survival relationships in that way. Don't try to do that. That'll take you away from the ordeal. Because you're saying, well, you can trust me entirely. I can trust you entirely. But the transmission of grace does not come from me or you. It comes from the root teacher. So what you should be doing is the preparation that the root teacher is suggesting. Okay, that's what you should be doing. That's the ordeal of preparation. That is the intensity of declarations that we have here. That's what you should be doing. Because waffling doesn't work. Now you may find yourself in a relationship where the other person allows you to do this, and you allow them to do that. You see, So there is some support. You're supporting one another to do this. Say, hey, yeah, yeah. Somehow your life works in that way, that you get the capacity to do it. Somehow I'm able to do this. You know, it's just a situation has just arisen. And so I'm doing it. Bringing the hammer down. Bring the hammer down. Right now, Jesus, bring the hammer down, because we absolutely need it. Those zombies are climbing our walls right now. So, you know, what do we say? What do we declare? I don't have a zombie problem. I do not have a zombie problem. I do not have a zombie problem. I have a continuity problem. The zombie problem doesn't exist. Therefore, has absolutely no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. You see? The zombie problem, climbing my walls. I do not have a zombie climbing my walls problem. I do have a very severe continuity problem, yes. But the zombies climbing my wall problem doesn't exist. Does not exist. Only, therefore, it has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Okay, this is bringing the hammer down. Use the continuity problem. That is the hammer. All right, when you get this, the rabid dog. I do not have a rabid dog problem. I do not have a rabid dog problem. I have a severe continuity problem, yes. But the rabid dog problem does not exist. Therefore, it has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Don't worry how this works. It does work. It does work. I do not have a body problem. I don't have a need problem. I don't have a world problem. I only have a continuity problem. All I see is the vision of oneness. All I see is the vision of oneness. There's nothing else to see. All I see is the vision of oneness. There is nothing else to see. All I see is the vision of oneness. There is nothing else to see. All I see is the vision of oneness. There is nothing else to see. It's a funny thing that most Americans, you know, may not be getting this, because we're so used to things being, you know, seemingly great, especially after World War II. You know, we think, oh, we got no problem here. Well, but actually, a lot of people are saying, wait a minute, uh-oh, we got a ton of problems here. But other people in other places around the world, especially those who have gone through stuff and they've seen how it happens, they say, hey, yeah, the rabid dog does come to my door. Yes, it does. Yes, it does. So they got a sense of urgency. Americans tend to be pretty complacent. Very hard to give them a sense of urgency. Very, very difficult. They think that, oh no, we live in the best country in the world. Can't happen here. Therefore, there's no reason to even pay any attention if it's happening here. It cannot. We know that. We're special, special country, you know. I was driving a couple days ago, maybe yesterday, yeah, Friday, and there's this big truck ahead of me. Actually, it was off to the right middle lane. I was in the left lane, and it wanted to merge in, so I let it merge in. I said, what's that truck carrying? What are those? These concrete boxes or something. Well, I saw where they turned, and down that road is a cemetery. I said, you know what? Those are coffins. Those are crypts. Those are concrete coffins. That's what they're bringing. I said, wow, death is happening in this neighborhood, isn't it? You don't normally see that. Never seen that before. A whole lot of concrete coffins. I mean, delivered. And just say, wow, yeah, the pursuit of oblivion is right here. It's everywhere. It's everywhere. And the older generation of Americans, they think, oh no, everything's fine. But if they look carefully at the younger generation of Americans, they'll see them all doodling death skulls, you know, and you say, wait a minute. They have those same rabid desire to pursue oblivion. And they'll start structuring and restructuring everything so that it fits in their agenda of rapidly pursuing oblivion. And you'll start recognizing these people, a lot of them, they're zombies, aren't they? Yeah. Maybe everything isn't so great. But again, America's probably the last place that people really have a true sense of urgency to actually practice. The ones that will succeed are the ones that actually practice, that put themselves through the ordeal of preparation. That will succeed. That will succeed. The complacency says, well, maybe I'll do it later. It's not going to happen here for a long time. Maybe it could happen at some point, but, well, this world is always pursuing oblivion. Just because it's not ultra-rabid where you think you are doesn't mean it's not severely intense. It's always severely intense here. Always. But it's about to get a whole lot more intense. And you don't want to panic at that time. You want to already have the structure, the liturgy, the understanding, the ordeal already into it. Pursuit of oblivion right there, like a bunch of gunfire, right on cue. Right here in our ultra quiet neighborhood, right? You just heard it. Wow. Right on cue, holy smokes. We all think we live in a nice neighborhood here in the USA, most of us. No, not so nice anymore. Wow, right on cue. So you don't, all the parables that Jesus gave us saying, be prepared, be ready ahead of time. Don't be like the foolish servant, the one that goes off and he doesn't pay attention to what the instructions were, the master's instructions for the house. And so when the master comes back, he says, where's everything I told you to do? Oh, you want me to do that? Yeah, I told you to be prepared. I got distracted. I was waiting. Too late. Have your lamps lit. All those parables saying, be prepared ahead of time. Be prepared ahead of time. Already prove to yourself you can handle the ordeal of preparation. Already prove to yourself you can handle the ordeal of preparation. Already prove to yourself you can handle the ordeal of preparation. Then, when things really get bad, you say, that's all right, I can handle the ordeal of preparation, and then you do it. But if you haven't done that ahead of time, you say, what do I do? And you'll panic, and then you feel like you can't handle the ordeal of preparation. It's too much. And then you're trying to, form panic relationships, which I cannot do. Cannot do that. You start looking for idols to worship, saying, you can give me transmission. You can do this. And no, I cannot. No, I cannot. So, those people, like Jesus said, will be in big trouble. Wailing and gnashing of teeth. If no one has been paying attention to what's coming down the road in this world, that's their fault. That's their own continuity fear. That's their pursuit of oblivion. They're so into pursuit of oblivion that they don't even pay attention. They see it coming. They say, good. That's great. Nothing wrong here. Nothing wrong here. A lot of people say, there's nothing wrong with the world because they want oblivion. Nothing wrong. things turn on a dime in this world, actually. Look at World War I. It happened in a matter of days. People were dancing and drinking and partying and jazz age and just like, wow, the world's great. This is like amazing. In a matter of like a week or so, the world war was on. And that went on, and it was just absolutely horrific, actually. Pursuit of Oblivion was like full blast, just suddenly. Pursuit of Oblivion goes full blast suddenly. The Pursuit of Oblivion goes full blast suddenly. And the media is all primed and ready to bring it to you on your, huge flat screen surround sound theater 24/7. So you can immerse yourself in your hope for Oblivion. So you can say, wait a minute, I don't want that. Wait a minute, no. Okay, we've got a structure here, and we've got the capability here to really bring the hammer down with the declarations, the affirmations. It's just a matter of doing it. Just a matter of doing it. Do it ahead of time. Do it ahead of time. Do it ahead of time, so to speak. As if time doesn't exist. Space doesn't exist. Time-space doesn't exist. It's never existed. It never will exist. Time-space doesn't exist. Time-space has never existed. Time-space will never exist. I don't have a time-space problem. I have a continuity problem. The time-space problem doesn't exist. Doesn't exist. Therefore, it has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. If something doesn't exist, the time-space problem doesn't exist, it doesn't. How can it be a problem for me? It doesn't exist. Only the continuity problem is the problem that I have. I don't have any other problem. So, the time-space problem doesn't exist. The time-space problem will never exist. We'll start off, there is no time-space problem. Time-space problem doesn't exist. The time-space problem will never exist. There you go. There is no time-space. No, time, the time-space, time and space does not exist. Time and space does not exist. Or time-space does not exist. Time-space does not exist. Time-space has never existed. Time-space will never exist. There is no time-space. Time-space doesn't exist. Time-space has never existed. Time-space will never exist. There is no time-space. There's only the vision of oneness. There is only the vision of oneness. So time-space doesn't exist. Time-space has never existed. Time-space will never exist. Time-space doesn't exist. Only the vision of oneness exists. There is only the vision of oneness. There is only the vision of oneness. There is only the vision of oneness. The world doesn't exist. The world has never existed. The world will never exist. There is no world. There's only the vision of oneness. Yes, yes, yes. The world doesn't exist. The world has never existed. The world will never exist. There is no world. There is only the vision of oneness. Yes, yes, yes. The world doesn't exist. The world has never existed. The world will never exist. There is no world. There is only the vision of oneness. Yes, yes, yes. Now, on these longer declarations, I need to do like just one at a time. It's too long. So we can say, The world does not exist. The world has never existed. The world will never exist. There is no world. There's only the vision of oneness. Yes, yes, yes. And then you try that. The world has never existed. The world doesn't exist. The world has never existed. The world will never exist. There is no world. There's only the vision of oneness. Yes, yes, yes. The world does not exist. The world has never existed. The world will never exist. There is no world. There is only the vision of oneness. Yes, yes, yes. Remember, this is an ordeal, so we don't give up easily here. There is, oblivion does not exist. Oblivion has never existed. Oblivion will never exist. There is no oblivion. There's only the vision of oneness. Yes, yes, yes. Oblivion does not exist. Oblivion has never existed. Oblivion will never exist. There is no oblivion. There is only the vision of oneness. Yes, yes, yes. So put yourself through the ordeal so you know how to do it. You prove to yourself you can do it. Once you prove to yourself, nobody can tell you that you can't. As long as you're trying to get someone else to tell you, oh yeah, you can do it, it's not good enough. You have to do it yourself. Prove it to yourself. And nobody can tell you that you can't. You'll just shrug them off and say, you don't know what you're talking about, you're wrong. I can do it. Oblivion does not exist. Oblivion has never existed. Oblivion will never, ever, ever exist. There is no oblivion. There is only the vision of oneness. Yes, yes, yes. So when the zombies are climbing your walls, you have to have these techniques ready. There is no... Zombies don't exist. Zombies have never existed. Zombies will never exist. There are no zombies. There's only the vision of oneness. Reality is definition free. Reality has always been definition free. Reality will always be definition free. Reality is definition free. Yes, yes, yes. Reality is definition free. Yes, yes, yes. Reality has no needs. Reality has never had any needs. Reality will never have any needs. Reality has no needs. Reality never has had any needs. Reality will never have any needs. Reality is need-free. Yes, yes, yes. Is always all, yes, yes, yes. All is always all, yes, yes, yes. All is always all, yes, yes, yes. All is always all, is always all, is always all, is always. Now, this is a circular thing, and everyone can say that. Just all is always all, 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 is always 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 always. Yes, 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 yes. These are forms of declarations. Yes, 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 yes. Drives it home. That's a hammer. It's using the hammer. Use the hammer. Use the hammer. Yes, 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 yes. Off to infinite, yes. All is always all. All is always all. All is always all. Nothing has ever happened. 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 Yes, 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 light, 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 light. I don't have a people problem. I have a continuity problem. The people problem doesn't exist, therefore it has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I don't have a fear problem. I have a continuity problem. The fear problem does not exist, therefore it has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. So, we can end up here with the creed is, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me to be. I have no needs, there is no world. I see only the vision of oneness, the miraculous play of living light. I am free, I am free, I am free of objectivity. Yes, yes, yes. I confess I have a very, very severe continuity problem. It's the only problem there is. The only problem I have is the only problem there is. I cannot have any other problem. I will never have any other problem. And I confess that the vision of oneness is the resolution to the one and only problem that I have. So all thanks to Jesus, all thanks to the Holy Spirit, all thanks to all teachers, who have brought inspiration and continue to bring help to the world. And all thanks to us. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about us and God co-creating. Right? It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about us and God co-creating. All right. Very great. That's it for this video.